Okay, let's move on to the next section here because we have another kind of unboxing to do. This was amazing. You have to walk me through how the hell you made this happen because you got original Kirby art and it just doesn't make sense. You didn't pay enough for this. It's an eBay sale, so I know that you're not going to care about how much we talk about, like how much you spent on it, because, dude, I'm lost for words. This is sitting in front of me. Monsters, issues number 12.
This is Monsters on the Prowl 12, a book from 1971. It's got Jack Kirby pencils and Maurice Severin alterations to it. I just picked up a Jack Kirby monster cover for like a ridiculous price, and I'm still floored at it. And I keep trying to understand how it happened. Okay.
Crazy.
But I paid $2,700 for it.
$2,700 for original Jack Kirby.
Right. Which is just crazy to me.
Look at those Kirby hands, dude. It's so cool. And Marie Severin, she helped a lot, which is, I think, also makes it pretty damn cool, too.
Yeah. It's just amazing when I get it in hand. I mean, it was already cool on the computer. But when I get to hold it and actually look at it and think about the history of it, I just can't help but geek out on it.
Let's geek out on it. All right, just start going through everything on here that we're excited about because there's a lot of minute details that excite us as collectors.
So we're looking at this huge mummy just walking down the aisle of what looks like a tomb. But it could be a museum because you have all these people in clothing and like day-to-day wear. So I'm thinking this is more like a really nice museum or maybe some type of a historical site. And they're just people checking out the pharaohs and the big tombs. And this living mummy, okay, called Gamdula, comes marching down your path, stomping with his big old marshmallowy Kirby hand feet and these bandages.
He's like literally, it almost looked like he's about to jump off the page with that foot the way it's extended.
You're right. With the perspective this has,
yeah,
it's just exactly
that,
what it looks like.
Kirby action shot, man.
Yeah, it's amazing. And you feel the weight of the character, the motion, the fear of it. And you can only imagine, like, this, 40-foot creature coming at you.
Right.
If you look at this really closely, you can really see the detail of what has happened with this page.
You get a little bit of the history with all the different defects, but also things they did to manufacture this cover.
A lot of the times, there's a lot of cut and pasting. So they had the word bubbles. And you could tell that if you look carefully here, that a word bubble was here at one point, but they changed their mind.
How can you tell?
Because the printed version actually has the word bubble on the far right. So it should be right over this foot. And you could tell that maybe it was tried here first, but the final was to the right corner. And you can see an edge, little piece of the bubble right in the corner. It's in white with a pen. So you'll see corrections. So you'll see white ink. And white areas, white it out.
Yeah,
and black ink's coming over. Because the copy machines aren't going to pick this stuff up. So you can see all the history behind it of what's happened with this page.
It's like OG Photoshop, just layers on layers.
Exactly. And that's just kind of how it was built. I mean, it was monster taped, put together.
Yeah, it's like got texture. You can feel it. You know, it's in plastic, so it's okay to touch. But you can feel the different levels of the comic move because there's different layers. And you also see corrections and pieces that are even missing because over time, some of these fell off. I mean, this is like glued together. It wasn't made to last. It was made to make the comic the first time and really only that.
And then tossed away. That's what it was for.
Unfortunately, a lot of his work in particular was kind of just tossed away, given away. You know, he didn't get a lot of it back, unfortunately.
And that was the history for artwork. It came, it went. It wasn't held on, so that keeps the scarcity level at a high for these older pages and covers. And if you look in the back, there is a stamp of authenticity that it was approved on March 2nd, 1971, and then initialed. Like you would assume, this has everything to prove its authenticity. Through time, it did have some wear. You have seen some moisture damage to it as well, but nothing severe. This piece really does just stand out and pop. And hopefully get it framed and hang it somewhere, if my wife would let me.
Kirby was known to be able to just like start anywhere on the page. And I like to think that he drew maybe like one of the limbs first and then was like, you know what? Let's just have this leg protruding almost off the page. We'll draw that next. And then he's like, oh, let's work on the pharaoh right now. And he would just go all over the page. His brain worked like that. He's such a fascinating gentleman. And you know what? Marie Severin helped out a lot. She did a lot of the cleanup work. It's like the comics, you know, they come in, but like Stan with text, he would do a lot of added excitement to kind of make it more vibrant, you know, get it a little bit more pop, a little bit more flair. Well, the art, Marie Severin did a lot of that for different Marvel covers, and she like added the spice. She's like a little bit of the spice on the cover. She changed some things, and it's kind of a combination of both of them working together.
Yeah, she was a master at her craft, and was around a very long time, a very accomplished artist and colorist for EC at one point, and then through the 50s of Marvel as well.
There's actually another comic book I want to mention that Marie Severin helped make a little bit more smooth, a little bit more eye appeal, a little bit more of that spice that I described. And we're talking about Hulk Annual Number 1. You know this cover well.
We all know this cover. Hulk is literally holding up his title, the Hulk. His back is breaking. Rocks are crumbling from the Hulk title. There's fire in the background. This is a very classic cover. But it was not done perfectly by Jim, at least to Marvel standards.
Yeah, I chatted with Jim about this, and he described it like this. He thought that the Hulk is a monster, which he is. He also thought that if the Hulk is like holding his whole title up, this guy would just be like, you know, it's heavy, and he's so much strength is needed, and it's probably wearing him out. And he already looks ugly, right? So he's got to look stressed, and his face needs to look scrunchy. And that's what he drew. He drew a scary looking Hulk face, which is kind of what you would expect, right? But Marvel thought, it's a little too ugly. So Marie Severin remastered the face, gave Bruce as the Hulk more of a clean look. And that's what actually was published. So you have Steranko's cover with a different face. And I'm bringing that up today because there is a foreign comic book that I am hunting for before January, and I hope to get it because when this came out on the stands with the Marie Severin alteration, well, or enhancement would probably be a better way to say to some collectors. Let us know in the comment section below, which face do you like better? I'm curious to know. Personally, I'm a Steranko diehard, so I'm looking for an original piece. And what's crazy is that foreign countries that reprinted this comic book, they included Steranko's original face. So I'm now shopping different foreign comics for my favorite cover with the original face specifically. I don't know if I'm going to be able to find it, but there's one that has more rocks on the cover. They altered the covers. So there literally are different things that would make me want one cover over the other. And the finished version has more rocks. It has a Steranko face. And I'm after it so hard.
I hope you can find it at some point, man. I don't know how hard it is to find. I can see why you'd want Steranko's. I mean, I don't like the... I think Marie Severin crushed this face.
She did, man. But, dude, so it's good. Steranko.
But
it's Steranko.
For the purity of it, and you just want that Steranko the way it should have been.
I need that sexy Steranko signature on, man. I got to grade it. It's going to be so dope. And you know what? I'm very proud to say that post our foreign comic book podcast and the releases that we've done and talking about it more, I have made some really cool friends. Shout out Matthew Roybal. And he actually hooked me up with somebody in freaking Greece because I'm looking for a comic book to talk about on the show, but it was only released in Greece, this particular version. And he found me someone in Greece and I freaking bought it from him. So I have a comic from Greece being shipped to me right now. And Matthew's also hunting me down this version. So hopefully I have some more updates to tell the community.